why discuss Gyan Yoga? As Jnana gives Vairagya. So whatever subject matter Krishna have discussed, chapter 2 is a summary of whole Bhagavad Gita. And rest of the chapters are elaboration, particularly up to 17th chapter. 18th chapter is a conclusion. So in this particular chapter, you will have discussion on 6 questions asked by Arjuna in the set of 3. The first set is Purusha and Prakriti. He asked Krishna, my dear Lord, who is this Purusha and who is this Prakriti? Second set of question is, what is Kshetra and Kshetragya? What is Kshetra and Kshetragya? Kshetra means field of activity, and Kshetragya, Gya means knowledge. Who is the knower of the field of activity? And the third set of question is Jnanam and Jnayam. Jnana means what is the process of knowledge, and Jnayam means what is the object of knowledge. And these 6 questions are the major subject matter of your Upanishads. The vast Vedic scriptures that we call as Upanishads and other under its umbrella, all that Vedic scriptures, 108 Upanishads and whatnot we have, the whole subject matter of that is this 6 prominent questions. So chapter 13th is the most complicated chapter of Bhagavad Gita, yet is the most important chapter. Well, I should not say yet is the most important, because every chapter of Bhagavad Gita is important. But what in context I'm saying is the most important means, whatever this Upanishad, after reading 108 Upanishads, vast literatures, what answers you will get, Krishna have given you in less than 35 verses. Krishna has given you all that wisdom in less than 35. So if you read this chapter, you have learned all the Upanishads, because these are the 6 prominent questions of Upanishad. What are the 6 prominent questions? Purusha, Prakriti, Kshetra, Kshetragya, Jnanam and Jnayam. Process of knowledge and object of knowledge. So here, I'll just give you a quick 2-2 line overview of the 6 chapters of this Jnana Yoga. I just described to you what is chapter 13th. After chapter 13 comes chapter 14, which is titled as 3 modes of material nature. And Krishna has a nice laughter when he begins this chapter. He's cracking up. Why he's cracking up? Krishna is saying, everyone thinks I am the doer, I am the controller. And then Krishna says, Arjuna, let me tell you a confidential knowledge. Arjuna says, my dear Lord, what it is? Arjuna, people think they are the controller and they are the doer. But the fact is, they are nothing more than a puppet. They are nothing more than the puppet. You know the puppet show? There is a puppeteer, has the strings, and is pulling the string, and the puppet is dancing to the strings of the puppeteer. Krishna says, similarly is the life of each one of us. All of our actions, all of our thoughts, how we act, how we think, what we like, what we dislike, everything is governed by a very important subject matter which is discussed here, is by the modes of material nature. Each one of us are affected by a mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. If something is prominent, let's say mode of passion, accordingly we have our eating habits. Accordingly we have our sleeping habits, working habits, walking habits, whatnot. Accordingly we speak. It's all affected by the modes. And Krishna says, yet the puppet thinks he is the puppeteer. And that's the reason Krishna has a great nice laughter in this session. And then Krishna comes to the 15th chapter, titled as the Yoga of the Supreme Person. Krishna says, people are so much in ignorance. First, they think they are the controller. Second, they think they are the proprietor. They think this belongs to them. This is their property. This is their possession. Imagine you check in into a hotel room. You get inside the hotel room and you begin to renovate that hotel room. You take out all the tiles thinking that I would like to have this hotel room like I want it. You take out all the paintings and all what you have on the hotel room, and you try to set it up according to your interest. Would anyone call this person a crazy person or not? It's a hotel room. It's a temporary place. This is not your permanent place. And Krishna says, like that, we are trying to find permanent happiness in a temporary place. We are trying to find a permanent, or we are trying to create a permanent comfortable situation of our life in this temporary place. And through this chapter, Krishna introduces the subject matter once again about the spiritual world, and he tries to attract our attention to our original home, that is spiritual world or adhyatmik dunya. There was a man who went to visit a sage. He was told that at such and such place, that's the house of the sage, go and meet him. When this man entered the house of the sage, he was shocked, because in that house there was nothing except for the sage and the mat on which the sage was sitting. And immediately this man asked, "Where are all your possessions? Where are all your belongings? Isn't this your house?" And the sage looked at this man and said, "Where are all your belongings?" And the man said, "Well, this is not my house." And the sage said, "Well, this isn't my house either. I'm just temporarily living in this house, which means the world." That's the whole idea. And through this chapter, Krishna brings out that knowledge through the discussion on that. The next chapter is chapter number 16, the divine and the demoniac. In this world, always there are two kinds of people. One is divine and demoniac. And Krishna speaks about the qualities and the characteristics of both the divine and demoniac. Simultaneously, he also exposes the attitudes and behaviors that are detrimental or harmful for one's journey in the spiritual life. The attitudes and behavior that are detrimental for one's progress in spiritual life are also discussed in this particular chapter, the divine and demoniac. This is all under Jnana Yoga, this, you know, the concluding chapters. Then it comes to the divisions of faith, chapter number 17. If you all see, life is not, you can say, like a black and white. You cannot say one person is divine, another person is demoniac. All of our life experiences teaches us that we have different faces, which means at different times we exhibit sometimes divine propensities, sometimes demonic propensities. Yes, we all have that experience. And that is what Krishna brings out the subject matter here, that faith, the faith that we carry, is also influenced by the modes. If the mode of ignorance is prominent in you, you will have a certain kind of faith at a given point of time. If mode of passion becomes prominent in you, then you will have a certain kind of faith at a given point of time. Have you seen people? They act at a given point of time in a different manner, and suddenly in a different situation, a different time, they act entirely opposite to it. Yes or no? And when they act opposite in that way, they are very convinced what they are doing. And that is what the subject matter. The faith is also affected, influenced by the modes you are. A very important discussion here. And then comes the concluding chapter, the perfection of renunciation. Chapter 18 is a conclusion of whole Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna, through the message of Bhagavad Gita, brings out the message that an opportunity of permanent happiness and fulfillment is given to everyone through the achievement of Krishna consciousness. One who is practicing Krishna consciousness, he has an opportunity to access permanent happiness and fulfillment of life. And that achievement of Krishna consciousness is said to be the perfection of renunciation. What is the perfection of renunciation? When a person develops or comes to a stage of full Krishna consciousness. And what is the consequence of this stage? Or what is the symptom of this stage of perfect renunciation or full Krishna consciousness? In that stage, Brahma Bhuta Prasanatma Na Sochati Na Kangshati. Which means at this stage, a person can smile in any situations or among any challenges, because he knows that the smiling Krishna is always by his side. So he does not have to fear anything. And that is where chapter 18 ends, with this prominent message. So what is perfection of renunciation? Achievement of Krishna consciousness. That qualifies you to be happy regardless of any situation and circumstances. Because that time we have got the strong faith based on knowledge that this beautiful Krishna is always by my side to protect me. And that is what the culmination of Bhagavad Gita. With that.